way you've like started and pushing on so far. Happy New Year. Welcome today to the first committee meeting of 2018. I trust that everyone's had a good and enjoyable festive period and ready for the challenges and sort of enjoyments that 2018 will bring to us. First item is obviously apologies. Perhaps we have any apologies that we have here.
Chair, I've got Catherine Crone, Flatley, Roberts, and Wilson. I don't know any of those.
There's a few more around there. So
like Harry Howard,
Brandon Crone as well, Pam Thomas as well, can't be with us today. And Keith Deakin as well. I think that's everyone that accounts for. It'd be remiss of me not to mention that some of those members have unfortunately faced some adverse circumstances. Obviously, Jeremy Wolfson, just before Christmas, unfortunately lost his mum after a long battle with cancer and is still going through the bereavement process. So I know we'll all send our sort of deepest and sincere condolences to Jeremy and his family accordingly. Equally, Gillian Flatley hasn't been well for some time. She has had an operation and she's convalescing at the moment, so obviously we send our kind of best wishes for a speedy recovery. Likewise with Veronica O'Neill, Ronnie's not very well. She's in Western Hospital at the moment as well, isn't she, Ken? So if we can send our very best wishes in regards to her for a speedy recovery. And likewise, Harry Howard is fine, but his wife, unfortunately, is pretty unwell today, so he's had to stay at home with her. And if we can send him and his wife and all the family the best wishes for them also as well. Second item is declarations of interest, and that's just for me to remind anyone that if they do have an interest that they're aware of now, or anything that may occur during the proceedings of the meeting, just to raise that accordingly so we can make sure it's accurately recorded. Third item is the minutes of the last meeting. That's for me to advise that attached to your chair's note are some amended minutes, because one of the comments that Harry Howard made at the last meeting, you actually missed off the minutes that have been included in your packs. So that's included on the chair's note. But if that's agreed as an accurate record, I will move that accordingly. That's agreed? Super. And in that case, into the main substantive bits of the I've also been reminded that equally along the lines of the minutes from the last meeting, that if people would like a copy of the quality impact assessments that were referred to in minute 60, which I understand are quite lengthy, those are available if people want to make that recording. Okay then, moving on nicely then, we welcome back an old friend to the Budship, Mersey Travel now. David Brown, obviously we know well, he's joined us today with Sharon Keith as well, both from Northern Rail, to give us an update as to where Arriva Rail North is up to in delivering the franchise. So folks, over to you.
Which is the organisation made up of the local transport authorities in the North. And it is managed, it is one of the few devolved franchises which is managed by the Rail North Partnership based in Leeds in the north of England. I think it's also just to remind members that when this franchise was originally due to be let, the intention was it would be continued on the previous basis, which was subsidy from government would continue to decline, but that would be done through service reductions and fares increases. But it was the involvement of Rail North actually turned that around so that the subsidy reduction to government would be driven not by service reduction but by service growth and revenue growth. So this is now much more a growth agenda and delivering the services across the north of England that are so desperately needed. We operate a significant number of services, both commuter services into big conurbations, interurban services across the north of England, as well as a lot of rural services, particularly in places like Cumbria and parts of South Yorkshire. 476 stations, so again, a lot of stations ranging from very big stations that you're well aware of in the Liverpool City region through to unstaffed halts in rural areas. And we currently employ, and that number's actually wrong, it's over 5,800 people across the north, so we are also one of the bigger employers in the north of England. And just to give you a little bit of context, that number's grown in the last year, calendar year, by nearly 400 people. So we're a growing business. We employ more people now than we did a year ago. And just for context, last year we had about 26,000 applications for the new jobs that we were advertising. So we are an employer that people want to work for because of the transformation that we're driving, but also because the terms and conditions and the salary offer is quite competitive. One of the innovations that was brought forward in this franchise was the creation of the regional director roles. So this is such a big franchise, we decided to put in place four regional directors. Sharon is your local regional director, looking after parts of Lancashire, Cumbria, and the Liverpool City region, amongst others. And that really gives a local feel to it. So I've been sat in this chamber before under the previous franchise, but we've had a stakeholder manager that's come along, listened to all your concerns, written them down, and disappeared back to York for a little while and then come back to us, no doubt, in writing. But now we've got a team that is based over here to understand local issues, to respond to stakeholder needs, to work with community rail partnerships and station adoption, which I'm sure we'll want to talk about a little bit later. But really understand what you're doing here, making sure that we're playing our role, whatever it is that you, as the city region, are doing beyond smart city, if you're going to travel, whatever, and making sure that what we're delivering is to your satisfaction. So just a quick recap of some of the more exciting things that we've got in the franchise. The intention is that we provide more services, faster journey times, more frequent journeys in the evenings, weekends and Sundays, and trying to catch up with a sort of lost generation of rail travel in the north. We've also got a significant amount of money to invest in our stations. We have 476, but we do have a pot of money around £60 million, which is our contribution, and which we hope to match fund with local contributions from stakeholders to get more out of our £60 million to improve the station and pop. A key part of the franchise is improving the customer service. So actually, we're measured on the level of customer satisfaction, both on trains, so the onboard service that people get, but also the service they get from our customer experience centre and our stations. Trying to drive that forward is because we want our customers to be more satisfied, but also clearly that drives more fares revenue for us to make the franchise more sustainable. We're also investing significant amounts of money in safety and security. So we know that travelling on our trains is a safe and secure way of travel, but people's perception of travelling on trains sometimes isn't as high as the actual level. So we've invested in 55 travel safety officers who do a great job in complementing our conductors and also our station staff, providing reassurance, providing support for us in difficult situations, late nights, sporting events, etc. And we're also very keen that we work in partnership with our key stakeholders. And you know that we do a lot of work already with your team on the Smart North project, making sure that we're playing our part in our local initiatives. And on the December the 10th, that was the first significant change in the volume of train services that we operated. increasing particularly Sunday services and evening and weekend frequencies across the north of England. So the first sort of toe in the water on delivering improved timetable services. Although the franchise was let in April 2016, I think the first year or so has been quite one of considerable planning. So you don't suddenly get new trains and new focus trains just like that. But what we are starting to see now is those big promises around new rolling stock and refurbished trains actually coming to fruition. So we do have a significant number of new trains that are being built by CAF in Spain. I've got a little video just to show you how that's coming on. And they will be factory and track tested later this year and entering service later in 2018. We have, I think it's slightly more now, but we have 60 or 70 completely refurbished trains. So these are older trains, but they've been through and worked either in Crewe or Doncaster, using local resource to completely refurbish them, putting in new seats, internal and external refurbishment to make them look as if they're new. And the first ones of those are going through a further process of modernisation this month by having Wi-Fi and further digital capacity put onto those trains so that people can see where the next train stop is and use the Wi-Fi, etc. We also opened a new train servicing depot in Blackburn. I guess that was the first tangible piece of infrastructure, so we had the Rail Minister along to open that. But actually that's more than just a train servicing depot. We've also opened there a train crew depot, which is based in a very modern facility in a new office block. We doubled the frequency of services from Blackburn into Manchester from December, and we now employ 100 people in Blackburn that weren't employed there before. And of those, 70 of those jobs are completely new. The other 30 transferred in from Manchester and elsewhere. But the local impact in the Blackburn local economy is quite significant. So we've now got over 100 people there, all on salaries, probably in excess of £32,000 a year, working there, new jobs created. And that's really what the transport system is about. It's about creating that economic activity. And we do have a planned visit later this month to Spain to have a look at how the trains are going on. So hopefully Colin's going to press a little bit of technology in a minute. Just to give you a little bit of background, if you're interested in trains, this is the sort of technical specification of what the trains will look like. They will be completely new, a mix of electric and diesel rolling stock, and the first brand new train stock operated by Northern for many, many, many years. I think I remember a long time ago some trains being introduced in Manchester, which were the newest trains at the time. And I know I don't look it, but that's over 20 odd years ago. So it just shows you there's been a big gap in investment in rolling stock.